Good morning and welcome to our service on Sunday, May the 17th, 2020. We continue to come to you remotely and hope that you are not only enjoying our services on YouTube or Facebook, but they are also a blessing to you. I want to call attention this morning to just one announcement that was on the screen and ask you to be in prayer about it. As many of you know, one of the great ministries that we have here at the church is providing backpacks and school supplies for our school children. At this point, we're not sure when school will start, but it will be starting. And we're in the process of collecting the backpacks and school supplies. We had planned several fundraisers to raise the funds to purchase these items. But because of not being able to meet together, we've not had the fundraisers. So we're asking each of you to prayerfully consider financially supporting this ministry. One suggestion that's been given is if you received a CARES stimulus payment from the Treasury Department, maybe one idea is to be willing to tithe on the amount that you received and then give that toward the backpack ministry. That way we could raise the funds we need to complete this program and be a blessing to our school children. If you're willing to do that, you can either send a check to the church and designate it for Care for Kids, or you can send a payment through PayPal and note the same program so that it gets placed in the right fun. Well, thank you for considering that and praying about it, and we hope this service today is going to be a blessing to you. And let's begin with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you today for this opportunity we have to come together to worship. We pray that as each person is viewing this in their homes, that your word, your spirit would touch the needs and touch the lives of those who are hearing it. We thank you for the Spirit of Jesus, who is always in our midst, and especially during this time of crisis, we have that sense of closeness that he is indwelling us, walking with us, providing for us, and protecting us as well. And we give you the glory and the praise in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Welcome to worship today. What a great privilege and a joy it is just to join together and worship the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ, to worship God our Father, to invite the Holy Spirit to be active in our lives, and especially now as we worship. We're delighted to have the Fresh Hour family with us again today, and that would be TJ and Laura and Ava and Brady. Well, that's a new combination, isn't it? Breda and Avi, but we'll fix it. Brady and Ava, we're glad that you're here, and I know that you will enjoy them leading us in worship today. Join us now. Set aside everything that would distract you. Just focus in. Focus in on our way maker, the Lord Jesus Christ.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, you are here, working in this place. I worship you,
I worship you.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are here, touching every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you, I worship you.
See it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I can see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every life. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, meeting every need.
worship you. I worship you. Rejoice, the Lord is King, your Lord and King adore. Rejoice, give thanks and sing and triumph evermore. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord, He's the great Shepherd, the Rock of all ages. Almighty God is He. Bow down before Him, love and adore Him. His name
continue our service now as we read together our responsive reading, and that'll be on your screen. That'd be from the book of John. It's chapter 10 of John, verses 1 through 15, and as you can see, we'll be reading that from the Passion Translation. This is the section entitled The Parable of the Kind Shepherd. Jesus said to the Pharisees, "Listen to this eternal truth. The person who sneaks over the wall to enter into the sheep pen, rather than coming through the gate, reveals himself as a thief coming to steal.
But the true shepherd walks right up to the gate.
And because the gatekeeper knows who he is, he opens the gate to let him in. And the sheep recognize the voice of the true shepherd, for he calls his own by name and leads them out, for they belong to him.
And when he has brought out all of his sheep, he walks ahead of them, and they will follow him, for they are familiar with his voice.
But they will run away from strangers and never follow them, because they know it's the voice of a stranger."
Jesus told the Pharisees this parable. Even though they didn't understand a word of what he meant.
So Jesus went over it again. "I speak to you eternal truth. I am the gate for the flock.
All those who broke in before me are thieves who came to steal, but the sheep never listened to them.
I am the gateway. To enter through me is to experience life, freedom, and satisfaction.
A thief has only one thing in mind. He wants to steal, slaughter, and destroy. But I have come to give you everything in abundance, more than you expect, life in its fullness until you overflow.
I am the good shepherd who lays down my life as a sacrifice for the sheep.
But the worker who serves only for wages is not a real shepherd. Because he has no heart for the sheep, he will run away and abandon them when he sees the wolf coming. And then the wolf mauls the sheep, drags them off, and scatters them.
I alone am the good shepherd, and I know those whose hearts are mine, for they recognize me and know me. Just as my Father knows my heart, and I know my Father's heart, I am ready to give my life for the sheep. Let the Lord bless to us the reading and hearing of his holy word.
Let's continue now with our sermon scripture, which comes from the 7th chapter of Revelation. Be reading verses 1 through 12, and be using the Passion Translation. This is John's vision of the 144,000 servants of God. After this, I saw four angels standing at the four corners of the earth, and they were restraining the four winds, so that no wind would blow on the land or the sea or on any tree. Then I saw another angel ascending from the east who had the seal of the living God. He shouted out with a loud voice to the four angels who had been given power to damage earth and sea, saying, "Do not damage the earth, the sea, or the trees until we have marked the loving servants of our God with a seal on their foreheads." And I discovered the number of those who were sealed. It was 144,000 sealed out of every tribe of Israel's people. 12,000 were sealed from the tribe of Judah. 12,000 were sealed from the tribe of Reuben. 12,000 were sealed from the tribe of Gad. 12,000 were sealed from the tribe of Asher. 12,000 were sealed from the tribe of Naphtali. 12,000 were sealed from the tribe of Manasseh. 12,000 were sealed from the tribe of Simeon. 12,000 were sealed from the tribe of Levi. 12,000 were sealed from the tribe of Issachar. 12,000 were sealed from the tribe of Zebulun. 12,000 were sealed from the tribe of Joseph. And 12,000 were sealed from the tribe of Benjamin. After this, I looked, and behold, right in front of me, I saw a vast multitude of people, an enormous multitude, so huge that no one could count, made up of victorious ones from every nation, tribe, people group, and language. They were all in glistening white robes, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, with palm branches in their hands. And they shouted out with a passionate voice, "Salvation belongs to our God, seated on the throne, and to the Lamb." All the angels were standing in a circle around the throne, with the elders and the four living creatures, and they all fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, "Amen. Praise and glory, wisdom and thanksgiving, honor, power, and might belong to our God forever and ever. Amen." May the Lord bless to us the reading this morning of our scripture.
Thank you for reading for me, TJ, and also Pastor Harrell. Thank you so much. I love that verse from John chapter 10. There's a lot of favorite verses in there, but this is, I think, my favorite. When he has brought out all his sheep, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. Last time, we talked about the nuts and bolts of how to hear from God. It's a progressive process, and it's something we teach our kids at camp. In fact, it is the very purpose of Camp Cedar Creek, teaching our kids how to hear from God for themselves. And in this Kairos time that we are living in, we must be able to hear from God daily. So if you remember, raise your hand if you remember those three steps. I don't see anybody moving down here. So, oh, there's one in the back. Way to go. Number one, expect to hear from God. Expect him to talk to you personally and write down what he says. And number two, read the Bible expecting to hear from God. After all, he is the author, and he can make things very, very plain to you. Number three, set aside a regular time to hear from God. Normally, you know, when we have our prayer time, 9 o'clock in the morning, I set my heart to be able to hear from God, because I pour out my heart to him, and I know that he is talking back. And so it's a matter of expectation. It's a matter of making that date, that hot date with God, if you will. Today, I would like to unpack a passage from Revelation that has been mysterious for hundreds and perhaps even thousands of years. And I invite you right now to turn in your Bible to Revelation 7. And just hold that place till we get there. And you might want to make just a few notes when we get to there. When we deal with apocalyptic literature in the Bible, what we're dealing with is something that the readers of that time understood. They understood the symbolism. And it's up to us in our day and age, since we have lost so much of that, it's up to us to decode it. And so with the help of the Spirit of the Living God, that's what we'll do this morning. I'm going to invite you to stand as we pray to honor the Father God as we pray to him. Let us pray. Immortal, invisible, God only wise, in light inaccessible, hid from our eyes, most blessed, most glorious, the Ancient of Days, almighty, victorious, thy great name we praise. Beautiful Savior, Lord of the nations, Son of God and Son of man, glory and honor, praise, adoration, now and forevermore be thine. Spirit of God, descend upon our hearts. Wean them from earth, through all our pulses move. Stoop to our weakness, mighty as thou art, and cause us to love thee as we ought to love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. When I was a kid, we used to get these visitors every now and then. Now, Ava, I don't know if you've ever had these visitors come to your house or not, but believe me, they came to our house, and they were kind of regular. It was always two women, and they would want to talk to us about the Bible. And after they talked, they would leave us some literature. Well, then I grew up, and I became a young mother and had a house of my own. And believe it or not, there they were. They came, probably different people, but they came, and they were just came walking up that long driveway. I could see them coming because I lived up on the second story. And they wanted to talk about the Bible. I just met them at the door. and they left me the literature. And then, I want to tell you this. One time, you're going to have a hard time believing this, but it is the absolute truth. One time when I lived in Germany, sure enough, there's a knock on the door. There were the visitors, except this time, lo and behold, it was a man and a woman, and they wanted to talk to me about the Lord. Well, I had just come from the airbase, and I was talking to a man about giving his heart to Jesus. It had been a very intense time with this guy. And you know what? I was loaded. Because when they said they wanted to talk about the Lord, I said, oh, I love to talk about the Lord. He is my whole life. For me to live is Christ and to die is gain. And they just kind of backed away. They forgot to give me the literature. But later, I found it in my flower box. There it was. And then when we moved to Louisiana, you won't believe this, but I was actually sitting on the porch, and they came walking up. Two women had to talk about the Lord. So they talked, and they talked, and they talked, and they talked. Mm-hmm, really. And then they left me the literature. The last time I saw those visitors was when I lived in the manse. And you know what? They came knocking on that door. I answered the door. I knew what they were there for. And I said, you know what? There's two pastors that live in this house. And boy, they made a run for it. They practically ran down those steps because they knew they didn't need to be wasting their breath on me. You know who they were, don't you? They're false teachers. They're the Jehovah's Witnesses. Billy Graham says, don't even let them in your house. And I didn't. Well, there was something, though, that they said to me when I was a child that kind of stuck with me for a long, long time. And that was that in heaven, and they showed me the verse in Revelation, in heaven there's only going to be 144,000 people. Don't you want to be one of those 144,000 people, little girl? Hey, that stuck with me. Well, of course, I've gotten it straightened out. But if you haven't settled it in your mind about the 144,000, today is going to be your day because we're going to unpack it. What I'd like to do is just remind you that the people back then understood the symbolism. They understood the meaning of things that we don't. And those word pictures that the Apostle John wrote, they were real clear to those people then. And they were so encouraged. And so let's just start with where Pastor Harrell started reading. And that is, the imagery is of four huge angels standing at the four corners of the earth with enough power to keep the winds from blowing. No wind moving, not on the land, not on the sea, or even in the trees. And then another angel rose up from the east, holding the seal of the living God. And he shouted with a voice loud enough for all those four angels to hear. Now just imagine, this is how I kind of picture it in my mind, that one angel is at the North Pole, one angel is at the South Pole, one angel is over there where Europe and Asia meet, and one angel being in Central America, spread way out, and yet they could hear that mighty voice of the one angel. And he said, do not damage the earth, the sea, or the trees until we have marked the loving servants of our God with a seal on their foreheads. So So now we know that those four angels were sent by God to wreak havoc upon this planet. But now they are being told to hold off until God's people are sealed. And now it's not just one angel, but it's a company of angels assigned to mark God's people right there on their foreheads. So what is the seal? Are you ready for this? Later on we see, if we read just a little bit further, that people are going to be required to take a mark either on their forehead or on their hand to be able to buy, sell, get medical treatment, or anything. Whatever you do, don't take that mark. So I ask you again, are you ready for this? This seal that that big angel and all of his company of angels have is a seal of God. It's a seal to protect and identify God's people. Are we ready for it, really? I think so. The seal is the mind of Christ, for it goes on our forehead to seal our thoughts. Now, until we receive the mind of Christ, we are incapable of discerning correctly, discerning the time that we live in, discerning what our job is here on this earth. Now, I hope that you recall in 1 Corinthians 2, verse 16, that the Apostle Paul wrote that we have been given the mind of Christ. The question is, do you believe that? Have you welcomed the mind of Christ? Have you actually received it, opened it up? Are you putting it to use every day? It's a seal for protection. But in the last days, you better put on your seatbelt right now, because in the last days, it is a seal that qualifies the believer to command the judgments upon the earth, the righteous judgments of God. Now, this seal represents the nature of God. It's the nature of God being written right up here, and hopefully everybody can see it. I remember in the books, do you remember in the books that we read, that they could kind of see, they could identify each other because they could see that seal? Yes, that seal represents the nature of God. And there's a lot more to be unpacked for this. But today we're just scratching the surface because we want to get to the big deal. Well, so what's the big deal? What is it? I wish Callie was here. I'd say, Callie, what's the big deal? And she'd say, being able to hear from God for ourselves in times of pressure. So now we come in the Bible to that famous number, 144,000. Now I'm going to do something here. I've got to put down the mic to do it. John discovered the... number who were sealed. There you have it. It's 144,000. They were sealed out of every tribe of Israel's people. Now, it's not meant to be a literal head count. Of course not. You have to decode what it means. But the way that we know that it's not meant to be literal is if you keep on reading, just right after the tribes, it says, and then I looked and I saw a multitude, a vast multitude of people that nobody could count, so many people that no one could count it. So it certainly is not that 144,000. There they were, from every people group, from every tribe, from every nation, from every language, all dressed in glistening white robes and all standing before the throne, worshiping God and worshiping the Lamb. So you may be asking, well, why did they put in that number anyway, 144,000? What's the significance? Well, there are 12 tribes listed. 12,000 from each tribe making that number, 144,000. 12 is the biblical number of completeness. It represents God raising up his sons and his daughters who carry his image and his likeness. 12 is the number of Christ, perfection, nothing broken, nothing missing, complete. His number's not 11. Oh, no, he's complete. He made the complete sacrifice for our sins. His nature multiplied in his sons and daughters. Now, how is it that they come into this likeness of Christ? And here's the answer to that. It's a term that's used, Israel's people. Remember, they knew what that meant. Israel was Jacob, the one who wrestled with God. And he was completely changed into a prince and is given that new name of Israel. No longer Jacob, the thief, the manipulator, the schemer. Now, Israel, he who has wrestled with God, a prince. So God's sons and daughters, called Israel's people, are people like you and me that have wrestled with their selfish human nature and have overcome. They've been given that new name. They've been given that new nature. And they have become God's royal priest. 1 Peter 2, verse 9. At this point, our question is, well, how do we get there from here? And that's where the 12 tribes come in. So we're going to start with verse 5. And if you know your Old Testament history, you will notice that the order of tribes has been changed, and that some have been left off. The name of each tribe is significant. We're just going to brush the top of them today. And as you take the meanings of those tribes, you're going to see a spiritual progression that leads us on, leads us eventually to intimacy with the Father. And it's from that position of intimacy that we find the back and forth communion with the Godhead. So let's go ahead and look at those tribes right now. The first is the tribe of Judah. Judah was not the firstborn, but because Jesus the Messiah was born from King David's line, the tribe of Judah, it is listed first. Jesus is the firstborn of all creation, the firstborn of many brothers and sisters. You say that's me. The church. As we are born again, we become aware of the fact that we are children of God, born into the family with all the rights and privileges of the firstborn son. That's where our progression starts. It all starts with Jesus, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Next is Reuben, meaning behold a son. And as we are born again, we become aware that the Son is living in us and he is actually being formed in us. And then comes, of all things, Gad, a troop. Gad symbolizes the beginning of the victorious life of an overcomer. In the history of Israel, the tribe of Gad was known as the most fierce warriors. They were the ones that could be counted on to go into battle and to bring home the victory. And we are to be those fierce warriors. And you'll notice, right after you become saved, right after you become aware that Jesus is living in you, that you are immediately confronted with a spiritual battle. Gad is followed by Asher. Asher means happy. Now you just wonder. You wonder, how can I be happy if I'm right here in the middle of this battle? Well, that's the miracle, isn't it? That's the spiritual progression that we learn, that as we take on that nature of Asher, that we are happy, that we have come into a place of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. And do you know that we can find joy in the battle because we know who's in there with us, don't we? Yes. Next is Naphtali. Naphtali means wrestling. So I can hear your mind going, I thought we were done with this wrestling. I thought we already did that at the very beginning. And that is true. But the wrestling at this stage is a wrestling between your human nature and the call of the Spirit. It is the warfare between flesh and spirit. And you know, we have to fight a real fight between the temptation to stay in the natural realm rather than take our place in the realm of the Spirit, living in the realm where nothing is impossible with God. Living in the realm where you say, I am a child of God and earthly limits mean nothing to me. Can you see that this stage could be continuous? We just have to keep at it, always, to take our place in the Spirit. Manasseh follows that. He is the half-tribe of Joseph. You remember Joseph who went to Egypt, had two sons. Manasseh got a tribe named after him. And it means causing me to forget. When we get to that stage, we can lay aside all those memories of the spiritual warfare that we've been through. We can lay aside all of those battles in the earthly realm. And we can enter into the victorious life of Christ, that realm of grace and peace. Are we there yet? That's a question, isn't it? Simeon means a hearing ear. We come to a place where our ears are open continually by our choice to hear the voice of our shepherd. And if we're not careful, we could stop there and we could think, oh, now we have reached our goal. We're being able to hear from the shepherd now every day. But let's continue on because it gets better and better. You go through those struggles. Levi follows Simeon, and it means join to the Lord. So when we go through those struggles and we're able to put them behind us and we're able to find joy in the battle, we have that hearing ear. We are joined to the Lord. And it's the stage where I think probably every bride may find herself, that she is married to this guy and she has to make the choice. I'm joined to him. It's a choice every day, isn't it? I'm joined to him. Well, that's what we do, the Levites. We are joined to the Lord. We choose to be joined to him every moment. We take our place as the bride of Christ. We live in union with him. Issachar means reward or compensation. And so here we come to the place where, yes, rewards are promised and rewards are given. More than adequate compensation for all of our struggles. Zebulun means dwelling or habitation. We already have a taste of this, don't we? Where God actually lives inside of us. Yes, we could not manage it if God were not living inside of us, but we know every day God is with us, God is for us, and God is in us. He makes his habitation with us, never to leave. Jesus said, I promise I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. Joseph means, may he add. And I think what this says to us is that we have a responsibility to share the good news with our friends, with our neighbors, with anybody who is in our sphere of influence. To say to them, you know, you could be part of God's family. Wouldn't that be great to have God as your family? Is your really father, your provider? That's where we go with Joseph, the tribe of Joseph. And then the final tribe that's mentioned here, Benjamin, means the son of my right hand. What that means is, this is kind of complicated, okay? I'm going to probably repeat it. That through the travail of our difficulties, a true son or daughter of God's right hand will come forth. Through the travail of our difficulties, a true son or daughter of God, the right hand will come forth. Through overcoming tribulation and great, great pressure, we are given the privilege of sitting enthroned with Jesus at God's right hand. When we are part of the tribe of Benjamin, we become mature in the fullness of Christ. Benjamin means we can take the heat. Benjamin means bring it on. We become the warrior sons and daughters of God that reproduce. We become the sons and daughters that hear his voice. We become the sons and daughters that are ready to rule and reign in the kingdom of God with Jesus Christ. Let me encourage you today as you press on. Every one of us has to press on every day, don't we? We look to the future and we think, when is this going to end? We press on. Press on, because we are taking our place in the 12 tribes. Another way to think of it is, we are climbing Jacob's ladder. Every rung goes higher and higher. I'm looking at Laura, and that's what caused me to choke up, because if there's anyone who is climbing that ladder, it's our Laura. If there's anyone that's taken their place in the 12 tribes and making that progression, I know lots of you are. But when I see Laura, I see it. So let me urge you today to make it a priority to listen for God's voice. In these days of Elijah, these are days of great trial. They're days of famine and darkness and sword. May we make it our priority to declare the word of God. In these days of Ezekiel, may we call the dry bones of complacency back to life. Hear the voice of the Lord. In these days of the visitors, may we be the faithful and true laborers that bring in the harvest. And may we be like David, rebuilding the temple of praise. And that's our challenge. And the words of the Apostle James, you know who James was. He's Jesus' half-brother. He said, draw near to God, and God will draw near to you. Draw near to him. Be still and hear his voice. And then go forth in victory. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the challenge today. We thank you that this wouldn't have been put in the Bible if it was impossible for us to do it. We thank you, Lord, that you have said, start with me. Come in through the gate. Hear my voice, and I'm going to lead you. I'm going to lead you through all the progression that it takes to be in that special place near to the heart of God. To be in that special place at the right hand of God, right there with me. Thank you, Jesus, that you say that to us. And thank you for encouraging us, Holy Spirit, every day to forget our losses, to just pick up our mantle, to pick up our assignment, to carry the dove of the Holy Spirit with us as we go through our days. We give you the honor. We give you the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. today is in the garden. Let's sing it together.
For our prayer time this morning, I want to remind all of us of what the Apostle Paul wrote in the sixth chapter of Ephesians, verse 18, where he said, "Pray in the Spirit at all times and on every occasion. Stay alert and be persistent in your prayers for all believers everywhere." This morning for our pastoral prayer, I want it to be not just a prayer by the pastor just one time, but would like to encourage you as you're there in your homes to pray for some of these folks that I will mention this morning. You may not be able to do all of them, but as I read over the list, jot down a couple of names and every day pray for one or more of these prayer needs that we have. The first list I want to share with you are the names of our graduates who are graduating both from South Greene and also Greenville High. And those graduates this year for 2020 are Raymond, Emily and Katie, Callie, Josie, Marcus, and Ethan. So every day, pick one of them or all of them and pray for them. Also, there are some other prayer needs that I invite you to pray for. The Sams family. Also, in our own church family, Gary and Ted, Anna Ruth, and Dale Collins, and Petey Collins. Outside of my church family, but in the family of believers, we have Jess Curley, which is Boone's father, Kat's father-in-law, my sister Kathy, and my son Hunter. We also have Ron and Edie's family members, Eileen and Forrest Kopp. Invite you to pray for them. Sharon Clark's sister Kathy. Also Duncan Rogers, who's in ICU, that we will mention. Also Hope Drummond's, that's having surgery. Jeff Duncan, also having surgery. Susan Bannon. And also, as the Bible reminds us, to pray for our leaders. Our leaders here in our own congregation, our pastors and elders, but for the leaders of our nation and our state, for our president, our vice president. The Bible says to pray for your leaders, to pray for our governor, for our local leaders here in Greene County. I encourage you every day to spend some time praying for our military and our law enforcement, our firefighters, first responders whose life they risk every day, particularly if they're responding to COVID-19 cases. All of our medical and support personnel, doctors and nurses and others who deal with these patients. And also pray for our church as we begin to talk about reopening for the ministry of our church and for the growth of our church. So I invite you to pray for those needs this week. Pray for one or two or three or four. If you've made the list, pray for all of them. Remembering that our prayers, the Holy Spirit prays with us and for us before the throne of God for these needs. So with that in mind, let's bow for a moment of prayer. Eternal Father, we thank you. We thank you for the truth that the Bible reminds and tells us that you care for us. You care for the greatest need that we have and even for the smallest needs. And I want to this morning pray for our graduates who are graduating in a very difficult time. But they are going to rise to the occasion, and they're going to be not only successful, but make a contribution to our great nation. We ask you to bless them as they go into the next endeavor, whether it's college or whether it's work, that you will bless them and prosper them. We pray for the Sams family today. You know their need, Lord, and you know that you will be reminding them that there are many people praying for them. We pray this morning for our church family members, for Gary and Ted, for Anna Ruth and Dale and Petey, for their healing, that Jesus came to not only heal our spirits, but also to heal our bodies. We ask for that same healing for Jess Curley and Kathy and Hunter, for Eileen and Forrest. We pray that healing for Sharon's sister Kathy, for Duncan Rogers while he's in the ICU as a result of a bicycle accident, for his complete healing, for Hope Drummond as she faces surgery, for healing completely from this breast cancer, for Jeff Duncan as he has surgery for throat cancer. We pray and lift up Susan Bannon as she is battling this Parkinson's disease, and we pray for healing from that disease in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we also pray for our leaders as they are guiding our nation through a very difficult time, and we pray that you'll give them divine wisdom for our president and vice president and those in every agency of government who are working tirelessly and long hours to get treatment or vaccines for this COVID-19 virus. We pray for the military, who are not only protecting us in dangerous places throughout the world, but they're assisting in dealing with this virus, that you will watch over them, protect them. And for our law enforcement personnel and the ones in our church family that we know, for their protection, for Bill and Craig and Kim, Dustin and Emily. For the firefighters and first responders who put their lives on the line responding to not only accidents, but calls for transporting sick people, that you will protect them and watch over them. For medical and support folks in hospitals and clinics and doctors and nurses and lab workers and all those who are exposed daily to the risk of dealing with not only COVID-19 but other diseases. And Lord, we lift up our church today, and as we consider reopening and what is the appropriate time, we ask for your wisdom. We thank you for the blessing of the ministry of this church, and we lift up particularly the backpack ministry, that the need for funding for that will be met, and more than met. But most of all, we're thankful today for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who by his life, death, and resurrection has brought hope for each one of us. And we remember him today as we join praying the prayer that he taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." We come now to our time of offering, and as we have said before, we continue to thank all of you who are supporting the ministry of our church, either by sending your checks in through the mail or by paying through PayPal. As we see with the backpack ministry, the ministry here continues, and we continue to appreciate your support and your blessing. So this morning at this time, we remember that God is the source of all that we have, and all that we have belongs to him. We're stewards of it, and he asks us to make good use as we bring to him our tithes and our offerings.
We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship him now. How great, how awesome is he, and together we sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with his glory. The earth is filled with his glory. It's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. It's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. And together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with his glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with his glory.
filled with his glory.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Now, in the words of the big fisherman, if you bow low in God's awesome presence, he will eventually exalt you as you leave the timing in his hands. Pour out all your worries and stress upon him and leave them there, for he always tenderly cares for you. Be well balanced and always alert, because your enemy, the devil, roams around incessantly like a roaring lion looking for its prey to devour. Take a decisive stand against him and resist his every attack with strong, vigorous faith. For you know that your believing brothers and sisters around the world are experiencing the same kinds of troubles that you endure. And then, after your brief suffering, the God of all loving grace, who has called you to share in his eternal glory in Christ, will personally and powerfully restore you and make you stronger than ever. Yes, he will set you firmly in place and build you up, and he has all the power needed to do this forever. Amen. And now receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, now and forevermore. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.